listening to Phantasm Podcast, a horror death metal podcast for the old school. Join your hosts, Corey Gorechrist and Dr. Vincent West, as they stuff horror movie reviews and death metal interviews all in one body bag. Listen on iTunes, subscribe on YouTube, and like on Facebook, and head over to StageDiverRadio.com for more.
Hi everyone, this is KK Downing, formerly of Judas Priest, and you're listening to Phantasm Podcast. Crank it up as loud as you possibly can. Corey's your man.
Phantasm.
Corey Gorechrist, Phantasm Podcast. I have the privilege of speaking with one of the legends of heavy metal, KK Downing. He's here to talk about Heavy Duty, Days and Nights, and Judas Priest. It's due out September 18th. Very exciting autobiography. I got a chance to read it, and it's really incredible. It's an awesome read. How you doing today, man?
Good, thank you, Corey. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to reach out to the world and say hi. It's been a while.
Yeah. You know, one of my favorite guitar duos of all time was you and Glenn, and you know, you were always my favorite as far as your style and just, you know, the leather clad and you know, all that stuff. It just really drew me into the band more when I first started listening to Priest, and you talk about that in your book, and we'll get to that. But yeah, I guess we'll start from the top here. You mentioned, you know, you had a pretty different home life than a lot of other people did. And, you know, you went through a lot of, you know, tough times, and it pushed you out to go try and just do something different, you know. So talk a little bit about that, the way the book describes it.
Yeah, I think that, I guess, one of the main reasons I wanted to do the book, really, was to try to give everyone an insight, really, as to how things really were, because you never, ever really do know. But I think the thing is, you know, I want to say that, yeah, there was a lot of turmoil and friction and you know, eclecticism in the family. It was always not normal. You know, up until the age of 15 when I left home, and but I know that I'm not on my own. I know that there's lots and lots of people out there that suffered, you know, as kids growing up, because unfortunately, lots of us are born into families, you know, like that, really, where there's lots of hardship and stuff. So
right.
I think it was worth mentioning, really, so that people know that, really, if you dig deep and get yourself sorted, you know, like I did, then, you know, there's something good out there. You just have to go out there and find it, you know. And I think my message is that do what I did, everyone, you know, if you're in that situation, is to just escape, you know, set your wings and take off, really. Don't think things are going to improve, because they're probably not going to improve.
Right.
You've got to go out there and mix with normality, and as I say, it doesn't matter if you sweep the streets or clean toilets, you know, put a roof over your head.
Right.
Just mix with normality and find out what it is you want to do with your life, really. So that's a pretty important part of the book for me.
Yeah, and I definitely got that from it. Reading it is very inspiring, but also it's a solid message. Just, you know, not so much inspiring, but also it's like, hey, you know, you can do what you want in this world. You just got to go and try to do it, you know. You mentioned you saw Jimi Hendrix, which is pretty awesome, and that kind of inspired you to pick up a guitar, you know, and then you know, years later, you're with Priest on that same stage. So what, you know, how is that feeling?
Yeah, it's fantastic, very rewarding, really. Like I say, I for some reason became, you know, a music fan, you know, when I left home. Well, you know, I had kind of had the freedom to research and do what I wanted to, you know, and I found music, went to a lot of gigs and stuff. And like you say, I saw the great Jimi Hendrix in his heyday when he really was on fire.
Yeah.
You know, 67, the first time I saw him.
Right.
When he was a free spirit and his mind was in a good place, and he just was out to just destroy the world with his, you know, his incredible guitar playing and his incredible performing.
Right.
So even he, you know, a few times after I saw him later on, right up until he died, you know, I saw him in that year at the Isle of Wight Music Festival in 1970.
Oh, wow.
You know, lots of things were starting to happen to him. I've seen documentaries since that do document it, you know, business things, you know, whether it's drugs, business, whatever.
Right.
All of the travel, all of the things, you know. But so these were all the things that we all had to go through. You have to be very careful your journey through life. You know, even when you've been successful, things can be problematic. So all these things kind of creep into one's life and career and being.
Yeah.
So. There's no such thing as a euphoric journey through life. As we always say, like my grandmother used to say, you know, life is full of ups and downs, and it is.
Yeah. Because really, you know, there's always going to be the trials and tribulations to everything. It's never easy, you know.
No, and a lot of it is all about, you know, relationships, whether it's one-on-one, business, or whatever it might be, family, or whatever the relationship is. It's, relationships are the hardest thing to hold down, and, you know, and to be harmonious with your partners, like I say, whether it's working partners or loved ones or whoever it is, it's tough.
Yeah.
I mean, how many people out there listening now? Can I mention Family Guy? That's tough, isn't it? We're supposed to love and cherish and be harmonious with all of that family, right?
Wrong.
that can be hard work too, right?
Right.
It's no wonder with strangers you meet up, you have working relationships with, idiosyncrasies. You know, a big fancy word for. Strange things, I think, start to creep in, and it makes things interesting, put it that way.
Right. Let's see, I want to jump into some of these tidbits here. Some of the touring you did in 77, we did Stained Glass. It was an interesting time because there was, you know, the punk takeover in the UK, and you were saying how pretty much you and, you know, Priest and UFO were really the only heavy metal bands really at the time, you know, doing anything, and you know, Zeppelin and all them were kind of in hiding during that time, and you know, just talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, and like I say, even when you're successful, you're going along, you're gaining momentum, and then before you know it, something like that happens, the new wave and the punk thing. You know, it's UK like a megastorm, and you start to feel a bit threatened. You know, that there seems to be a disinterest in, you know, in rock and metal suddenly, and everything's new. And will we die out then? You know, you feel a bit threatened. Like I said, that one year, I swear that there's only Priest and UFO actually toured the UK, you know, in those years, 77, 78, whenever it was, you know, the height of it all. I know so many rock musicians that jump ship, and before you know it, they got this kind of new wave haircut and makeup and clothes and things. You know, thinking this is a better, you know, more of a chance of making a living doing this.
Right.
So that was tough, but I'm glad that we came through that, valiantly.
Right. And your first U.S. tour was with R.E.S.P. Wagon and Foreigner, which I thought was pretty interesting. And you talked about how, you know, in the U.S. it was very different with their shows, where they kind of just built up the headliner and made, you know, gave them all the proper lighting and all this stuff, and you guys kind of just had, like, you know...
Yeah,
there was some...
What it was, you know, we set sail, and everyone said to us, our management, you know, don't expect anything because you're not going to get anything. You just get out there and do what you do, and that's what we did. You know, no fuss, no nonsense. We did it. You know, we were just very, very grateful to be on a stage with them.
Oh, yeah.
In an auditorium.
Right.
We were super, super grateful. Even if they couldn't see us at times because we didn't have any lights on us.
Right.
It didn't matter. You know, we were very, very humble and very grateful. And I think it made us a better band for it, really.
Sure. And then in 79, there was a pretty cool part of the book where you talk about you and UFO seeing Blue Oyster Cult, which I thought was really awesome. And there's a little Hell's Angels story there, which I thought was pretty neat.
Yeah, I think we were both on tour. Maybe we were on tour together. It's a long time ago, but anyway, we ended up just going to that show. I think UFO was supporting Blue Oyster Cult. I think that's what it was.
Oh, okay.
Went down. Yeah, and of course, it all got a bit pretty funky. Obviously, I guess Blue Oyster Cult had a pretty big Hell's Angel following.
Right.
I don't know. We ended up. Don't ask me how, but we ended up back in this massive Hell's Angels den, you know, somewhere, and it was a night of escapades, really, you know, because UFO were a pretty rowdy bunch, I gotta tell you that. When it comes to rock and roll, UFO pretty much led the way, really, but lots of fun. But what a great band, you know, obviously one of my favorite bands.
Oh, absolutely.
Michael wasn't in the band at the time. Paul Chapman was, Mr. Indestructive, that's what I nicknamed Paul. I called him Tonka after the Tonka toy, you know. The Tonka toy is indestructible, and he was. I think they were all pretty indestructible, really.
Right.
Good time.
Oh, yeah, they're good. And then you did the part of the Highway to Hell tour with AC/DC, which was your first interaction with those guys.
Yeah, that was a fantastic, like I say, can't find enough good words to say about AC/DC. Obviously, we were opening up for those guys in Europe, and they were very, very good to us, you know, took good care of us, and that's how we learned, you know, what we were so grateful, you know,
right.
for small things, you know, really grateful for small mercies, you know. That AC/DC were able to help us out with a little bit, you know, a little bit with the transport, you
right.
know, a little bit with, you know, simple things, food and drink and stuff when we didn't have, you know, pretty anything. And that's what we felt. This is a good way, you know, to help bands that are on the way up. And as we say, you know, and hopefully those bands will turn around and help you when you're on the way down, who knows?
Right. Absolutely. Well, yeah, when you guys read the book, there's a lot of cool stuff around that time. Just, you know, when you're talking about Bon Scott and everything, that was really cool. So that's something I won't mention because it's really interesting. So that's definitely worth the read when you all buy it. So,
yeah.
British Steel, I thought was interesting because It was pretty easy for you guys to record that. It was just in and out, it seemed like. And then versus Point of Entry, which was just, you guys were a little distracted around that point.
Yeah, it's quite difficult, you know. I mean, I think Priest has always been a band that's been pretty versatile, whether that's a, you know, good thing or a bad thing. But in our eyes, that we were just trying to gain as much momentum and popularity as we could, and
right.
and bring as many people into the fold as of rock, which was. We were now, you know, a metal band, and
yeah.
and our message was that, you know, there's lots of good stuff here in this camp for everybody, you know. I mean, because it was such wonderful times, really, you know. I mean, we're very fortunate. I'm very fortunate, and I do say this, to have been born when I was, really, to have witnessed the evolution of music, you know. Yeah. All genres, really, that are important to us. I mean, we've been there to observe and to be able to judge and to make preferences and, you know, and just think of all the wonderful concerts that I've seen that people in the future will never, ever have had the opportunity to see. I mean, I saw Van Halen open up for Black Sabbath in my own town, you know, on the first Van Halen. You know, I mean, gigs like that, you just can't, you know, even if those guys were to get together and do it again, it wouldn't be the same.
No.
You know, just so fortunate, and to have been a part of it as well, you know.
Absolutely.
I'm so lucky, and I say, you know, irrespective of anything that happens, you know, I always say that I'm very, very grateful and respectful to my bandmates, and you know, we had a long journey together, a long career,
right.
and we were very successful, and it's what we did together has become historical, and I hope in the future that people will look back, and when people think of heavy metal, they'll think of inevitably the band Judas Priest.
Oh yeah, I mean, and even in that conversation, you can't even leave you all out. And you mentioned that in the book too. You know, later down the road, how Judas Priest was almost at one point not really considered, because there's other bands like in the conversation that were kind of a little more popular. But you know, Judas Priest just put such a stamp on heavy metal. You know, as far as just each record's, you know, it's definitely Priest, but it's always been just what you guys wanted to put out. It's always been, you know, very good. And, you know, going from, like, breaking, you know, British Steel to, like, Painkiller, you know, same bands there, but it's so much different, and it's all just awesome heavy metal music, you know.
Yes, I think that, such a long time, isn't it? Some 40-odd years, you know, 4 decades or even more. And, you know, making that journey, things change, you know, you change as a person, you know. Lots of things change in the world, you know. I particularly remember the 80s and mid-80s were the fun times, the golden ages, I call them, really, because...
Right.
So many bands were coming to town. There was a feel-good factor.
Right.
It seemed like the economy was pretty good. You know, I mean, there was a different band coming through your town, you know, to the arena every week, a great bill, you know, whoever it was.
Oh, yeah.
Everything seemed to be music. Everything was happening. You know, you walk out into the street and cars are just pumping music, you know. It was just a very, very, very comforting and a great time for everyone.
Oh yeah, and
you know, I mean, we went out there, Judas Priest, Def Leppard, and Judas Priest, Scorpions, and Def Leppard.
Yeah,
I can remember doing that tour in the States. You know, it was so many good, great. And of course now, we are, you know, fast becoming the dinosaurs, if not already. You know, I don't know what it's going to look like in 10 years' time, but anyway, right. Hopefully I'll still be rocking away on the porch or something like that, you know, but, you know, I'm still going to be there till the very end.
Oh, yeah. And then, you know, you guys made your stamp in the metal world. Apparently, you're still banned from Madison Square Garden, so that's interesting. They talk about that in the book. They'll find out why. It's a really crazy story.
Yeah, that was pretty insane.
Yeah, and then you got some mentions of some a certain movie that you passed up on at the time to be a soundtrack for. But that was fun too.
Yeah. So there's Top Gun thing. That was an opportunity missed, you know. But there you go.
Yeah, that's from Reckless from Turbo, which I've ever since the anniversary of that hit, I still listen to that record. It's just it's beautiful sounding. It's just retro, and it's I don't know. It's just a great metal album for sure. And and then in the 90s, you had the fun with the PMRC again, and you know that was a hard time for you guys and everybody.
Yeah, we went all through that.
And so there's controversy, there's, you know, there's definitely partying, and there's, you know, when you guys were recording in the Mediterranean there for a couple of those records, and then, there's a little bit of everything in this book, and I'm really excited for everyone else to read it. It's Heavy Duty, Days and Nights, and Judas Priest, and it comes out September 18th. KK, it's been an absolute honor having you on today. It's amazing.
Thank you very much, Corey. It's very kind of you to call up and, as I said, give me an opportunity to say hello to all the fans and the people out there listening, and keep up the good work, mate, in everything that you do. And I wish everyone out there, you know, a fantastic time. So until I see you next time, everybody take care and keep on pumping up the volume.
Thanks, man, so much. This is an absolute honor, and hopefully I'll talk to you again soon.
Thanks, buddy. See you one day, mate. Take care. All right. Thank you very much.
Hey, you too.